Good morning. I'm Jay Woodruff, a member of your parish committee. We're glad that you're here, either online or in person. Glad to see so many people here today, here in our beautiful sanctuary. A special welcome to any visitors who've come today. We look forward to talking to you after the service, if you like. Our mission is to build community, search for meaning, deepen our spirituality, and make a better world. To learn more about First Parish or Unitarian Universalism, please visit uuwayland.org or contact Kate Holland, Director of Lifespan Education and Engagement. Please reach out to a member of the parish committee or to Reverend Stephanie if you have ideas or questions about First Parish. A big thanks to all the other service participants whose names are in the order of service. And please note that Middlesex County currently has a medium risk for COVID. It's going down a bit. So we recommend that people mask. Any service participant that unmasks has tested negative for COVID this morning. Please join me now in taking a moment to say hello to each other, including a wave to the front camera to those online. A reminder today that today the nominating committee is holding a session in the sunroom downstairs to talk about their process and to answer any questions. And now we have an announcement from Evan Haddingham regarding our shared plate.
I tested negative this morning, so I'm going to take this away. 8 years ago, two women whom a story in the Metro West News described as local suburban working moms, Sharon Carlson and Andrea Hewitt, one lives in Concord, the other in Arlington, they're very close friends, and they became so concerned with the plight of people fleeing persecution in their home countries and seeking asylum in Boston, that they decided to set up a 501c3 nonprofit to offer free, safe housing to those would-be asylum seekers. Now, people seeking asylum in Boston, they fall through the cracks when they get here, unless they have family or some kind of network before they flee their country. They must wait for a hearing. The courts are so backed up, they have to wait for a hearing and a work permit for at least a year and sometimes 2 years. During that time, they can't receive support from any government-funded agencies for resettlement. And there are, of course, plenty of volunteer organizations offering health and pro bono legal representation, but there are no housing facilities set up for these people. So very often, they end up on the streets or in jail or in detention or in some abusive situation. So how did Andrea and Sharon respond? I can't do better than quote from their latest newsletter. "We called our organization Dignity in Asylum because the process of seeking asylum here is so humiliating and disempowering. We asked all our family and friends for donations and rented our first apartment where we would house three women seeking asylum. Since 2014, we have housed 72 guests that have come here from all over the world. They are human rights advocates, doctors, nurses, women's rights and gay rights activists, healthcare workers supporting marginalized groups, and politicians peacefully advocating for change. They're members of marginalized communities such as ethnic and religious minorities, the LGBTQ community, and those seeking gang violence. And they've had many success stories where, thanks to a lot of support from the community organizations in Concord, such as Share a Table, where people have transitioned from staying in the two houses that they rent in Maynard, transitioned for a few months, and managed to get their permit and have gone on to establish themselves in housing. Amongst the success stories, that they've had 14 families, they've had 4 babies born in the houses during those 8 years, and 6 people were freed from jail as a result of this housing being available. Now, Dignity has no paid staff or office. It's all volunteer work, and their administrative costs are just 6% of their budget. So practically every single dollar you give to this organization goes directly to paying the rent on those houses. And although there have been a lot of support from organizations, as I said, in Concord, it's still very much a kind of a month-by-month funding, dicey funding operation. So this is one of the few local organizations that I support wholeheartedly and have done for many years, because it just seems such a worthy organization. It really all depends on lots of community volunteers and these two absolutely remarkable women who put this thing together. Thanks.
Hello, I am the Reverend Dr. Stephanie May, and I too welcome you to today's service as we continue our monthly focus on Hinduism. Again, we gather together, as so many generations before us have done. Again, we enter carrying sorrows and hopes, joys and fears, all mixed within us. Again, we come to this hour, young and old, to continue along the path of seeking truth and meaning, community and love. Again, again, and again, let us return to the journey of seeking to more deeply love the wonder of life within and around us all. I now invite the Levine family to come forward to light our chalice and to lead us in our covenant, the words that say our promises of how we will be together and why.
Here we go.
With open minds and loving hearts, we gather to search for meaning, to care for one another, and to work together for a better world.
Good morning, everyone.
we have around. Jane's going to help me this on this one. Page 1011, and you should definitely look at the thing. So you'll notice that there are two parts, and that each part is repeated. So we sing part one through, and then we sing part one through again, and then we sing part two through, and then we sing part two through again. So what we'll do now is we'll all sing, as written, this whole thing from top to bottom, repeating both lines. Then we'll do it again, and this side will start, and then that side will come in when the appropriate time is, and Jane will bring you in. Are we ready? Polly, can we have an F?
Good morning. I'm Jim Gittendoff, and our story this morning is a Hindu tale entitled The Jewel. Once upon a time, long ago, an old man lived alone on a hillside. He was a sannyasi, that is, he had dedicated his whole life to spirituality. He had given up all his worldly possessions. Each morning he woke facing the east. As he watched the sun rise, he said his prayers. He lived a simple life, a quiet life, far from others. But in the village below the mountaintop, some people whispered about the old man. Gossip spread the way gossip will, and as the years passed, the rumors spread far and wide. People began to say that the old man was not devout. Rather, they said, he was a wealthy man who had moved to the top of the hillside to hide his wealth from those who might wish to steal it. Some argued, but he does not spend any money. Others countered, no, but one day he will. Others asked, why live such a simple life if he is so rich? Those who gossiped would shrug when anyone asked this question. That is for the old man to know, and one day we shall know his secret. One night, a poor peasant fell asleep, and he dreamed. In his dream, he saw a magnificent ruby, a ruby as bright as the sunrise, nearly as large as his own head. And in his dream, he saw that this ruby belonged to the old man on the hilltop. When the peasant woke, he decided he must have that ruby. It was so beautiful, and perhaps if he asked the old man to give it to him, he would agree. The very next morning, before anyone in the village was awake, the peasant began the long hike to the top of the mountain. That morning, when the old man awoke, he began to say his prayers, when suddenly he heard footsteps behind him. He turned and saw the peasant just coming over the rise of the hill, and so the old man greeted him. Good day. Welcome to the hilltop. Perhaps you'd like to pray with me. The peasant was terribly nervous, but he did not wish to pray. He could not take his mind off the beautiful ruby of his dream, and so without thinking, he simply blurted out, no, I have come for a ruby. I saw it in my dreams. Do you have a ruby that you will give to me? Without a word, the old man reached out into a clump of tall grass and plucked a ruby from its center. He handed the jewel to the peasant. Here it is. Take it with my blessings. The peasant could not believe his eyes. The ruby was truly as bright as the sun that now rose in the eastern sky, and it was nearly as big as his head. He held it in his hands, staring, and then he stared at the old man. You're too kind, he said. And before the old man could change his mind, he hurried back down the hillside. Hiding the ruby beneath his tattered clothes, he hurried to his hut, and there he placed the magnificent gem upon his little table. He stared in wonder. He turned it this way and that. He touched it, caressed it, even kissed its cold surface. I am the luckiest man in the world, he said, and all day long he sat that way. He did not eat. He paced and stared and imagined what would happen now. His life had completely changed. Tomorrow he would carry the ruby to the nearest city. There he would sell it for the highest price. Or no, he thought, perhaps he ought to keep the ruby, hide it somewhere safe until a day he truly needed it to keep himself from starving. Or no, he thought again, he would take it to the city and give it to a gem cutter who could cut it into many pieces. He could sell a ruby or two or even 10 and save the rest for another day. But what if the stonecutter told others of his ruby? Then he would never be safe. And perhaps after all, he should share his wealth. But once he told anyone about the jewel, thieves might break into his hut. All night long, the peasant stared at the ruby. And as he stared, he began to think of the old man upon the hillside, of the moment he reached into the grass and picked up the ruby. He thought of the man's simple life, his robes, his devotion, his quiet smile. And so once again, before dawn, he began to climb the mountain. This time he carried the ruby. And as the sun began to rise, the old man woke and turned to the east to begin his prayers. But once again, he heard footsteps behind him, and he turned to find the peasant standing there. Good morning, the old man said, bowing slightly. The peasant handed the old man the ruby. I do not wish to keep this, he said, but I do have a request. The old man nodded. I wish for you to become my teacher. I want to learn what you know. I wish to know how you gave this ruby away with such ease. The old man smiled. He said, "You have already begun to learn."
Thanks, kid. I now invite our kids to leave for Seek, and let's all sing them out. The Bhagavad Gita is a sacred Hindu scripture. It is a 700-verse poem that appears as a philosophical exchange in the midst of an epic poem about a great battle, not unlike the Iliad. The exchange is between a warrior, Arjuna, and the Lord Krishna, who has been serving as Arjuna's charioteer, but is in fact an incarnation of the god Vishnu. Facing the violence of battle, Arjuna questions the right way to live. In response, Krishna teaches him the path of wisdom. Our excerpt today comes from chapter 2 of the Gita. It is the most quoted passage, and Gandhi said it contains the essence of the Gita. You may hear echoes from Kit's story with themes of renunciation and seeking to learn the spiritual path. It may not entirely make sense to you, but I invite you to listen, open to hear a phrase, a word, an idea that resonates with you as we encounter words of soul-shaping significance for billions of people. Arjuna. Tell me of those who live established in wisdom, ever aware of the self, O Krishna. How do they talk? How sit? How move about? Krishna. They live in wisdom who see themselves in all and all in them, who have renounced every selfish desire and sense craving tormenting the heart. Neither agitated by grief nor hankering after pleasure, they live free from lust and fear and anger. Established in meditation, they are truly wise. Fettered no more by selfish attachments, they are neither elated by good fortune nor depressed by bad. Such are the seers. Even as a tortoise draws in its limbs, the wise can draw in their senses at will. Aspirants abstain from sense pleasures, but they still crave them. These cravings will disappear when they see the highest goal. Even of those who tread the path, the stormy senses can sweep off the mind. They live in wisdom who subdue their senses and keep their minds ever absorbed in me. When you keep thinking about sense objects, attachment comes. Attachment breeds desire, the lust of possession that burns to anger. Anger clouds the judgment. You can no longer learn from past mistakes. Lost is the power to choose between what is wise and what is unwise, and your life is utter waste. But when you move amidst the world of sense, free from attachment and aversion alike, there comes the peace in which all sorrows end, and you live in the wisdom of the self. The disunited mind is far from wise. How can it meditate? How be at peace? When you know no peace, how can you know joy? When you let your mind follow the call of the senses, they carry away your better judgment as storms drive a boat off its charted course on the sea. Use all your power to free the senses from attachment and aversion alike and live in the full wisdom of the self. Such a sage awakes to the light in the night of all creatures. That which the world calls day is the night of ignorance to the wise. As rivers flow into the ocean but cannot make the vast ocean overflow, so flow the streams of the sense world into the sea of peace that is the sage. But this is not so with the desirer of desires. They are forever free who renounce all selfish desires and break away from the ego cage of I, me, and mine, to be united with the Lord. This is the supreme state. Attain to this and pass from death to immortality. As with the anthem the choir sang a moment ago, the next hymn is also by Rabindranath Tagore, a Bengali polymath whose Hindu upbringing is evident in his poetry and music. As we prepare for this moment of prayer and meditation, I invite you to remain seated as we sing hymn 197, There Are Numerous Strings.
Thank you. I'm the ministerial intern here, and my pronouns are she or they. Please join me in the spirit of prayer or meditation. Let's take a deep breath in. And out, and out. Another deep breath in. And out. Spirit of life and connection. January can be a difficult month for many. It is cold and often tough to spend time outside. Days are short and nights are long, which can leave many of us looking for light, searching for warmth and connection. But January also brings it with it the opportunity to try again. It brings with it the beauty of snow falling outside our windows, the sight of leafless trees standing proudly, beautifully, against the stark and cloudy sky. And for many of us, it brings afternoons spent sledding or throwing snowballs, hunkering down in a warm living room playing board games, or reading a good book by the fireplace. May we remember that while every season on the calendar has its challenges, there is also joy to be found, a uniqueness that only this time of year can bring. May we be able to easily call to mind these delights this week and throughout this season. Blessed be. I now invite you to a moment of stillness.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Ted Barnes. I'm a lay minister here at First Parish. And this is the time in our service that we share joys and sorrows. In both our sharing and in the support given by our witness, we affirm our covenant to care for one another. To begin, I'll light a candle for the 10 people killed in Monterey Park, California yesterday, yet another mass shooting. And for my brother-in-law, Dan Collins, who has had a stroke. It's bad. And that's for him and all the really agonizing choices out in front of his family. I'll light a candle of joy to recognize the Lunar New Year, the abundance and good fortune to all those who celebrate, and also to our Zoom crew in the back, Lynn Kavanaugh and Lee Anderson, who answered the call. So this includes your current chair of the parish committee. So if that ain't Unitarianism, I don't know what is. If you'd like to share a joy and a sorrow, this is the time. Please come up to the front. I can bring the mic to you if you prefer. Incidentally, I tested negative this morning, so I have my mask off. You can also submit sheets of paper, and there's a chat.
Our shared play for this month is Dignity in Asylum, which Evan spoke to us about earlier. This group provides vital resources and support for some of our most vulnerable populations, and I hope you will be generous with your support for their important work. If you are online or you prefer to donate online, you can go to uuwayland.org/donate. You can text 833-264-0104 or download the Vanco mobile app. Or if you are in person, you may donate one of the boxes that are being shipped passed around. We will now gratefully receive the offering. Thank you for your support.
Call on the rest in soul, oh Galileo, King of Night.
It's 3 a.m. You've been awake an hour, maybe more. The conversation keeps repeating in your head again and again. Why did I say that? Why was I so cruel? Why can't I just learn to keep my mouth shut? Or you're sitting by the phone, despondent by the call you just received. Again. They have done it again. When will they learn? Will this destructive pattern just keep repeating itself again and again? I suspect some version of these scenarios are familiar to most of us. Too often our actions misfire in directions of harm or regret, or we painfully witness the damaging choices of a loved one while feeling helpless to alter the impact. Sometimes the trajectory of our choices made leave us shaking our heads and humming along to the Indigo Girls, "How long till my soul gets it right? Can any human being ever reach that kind of light?" The Indigo Girls may not be Hindu, but their song Galileo evokes an aspect of reincarnation that I did not understand. The cycle of birth, death, and rebirth, or samsara, is not a simple calculation of good and bad karma that determines your next life. It is an imprisoning trap. Again and again and again, the actions of one life following you to the next life. How much life and death can one soul take? How long till a soul gets it right? And is there, in fact, a way to escape the cycling of karma? Is there a place of peace and light beyond the recurring struggle of figuring out again and again the right way to live? In short, the Bhagavad Gita is a compassionate exchange between a man overwhelmed by such questions of how to live and the creator of the universe. The Gita, as the text is also known, begins with the warrior Arjuna taking stock of the vast armies lined up for bloody battle. As the battle is between warring factions of the same family for the throne, Arjuna faces the battle where he will be asked to kill family and friends. He hesitates. Must I? Is this really the right thing to do? Turning to his charioteer, who is none other than the Lord Krishna, an incarnation of the god Vishnu, creator and sustainer of the universe, Arjuna asks for help. "Please, Krishna," Arjuna asks, "what are my options? What's the best path forward?" Where do you turn when you're feeling stuck? How do you find the answers of what to do, what path to take? One of the challenges of being Unitarian Universalist is that there is not a clear answer to these questions. There is not a single sacred text or a canon of holy books to which we turn. Nor is there a singular authority whose learned wisdom or proximity to the divine conveys the right answers. While the absence of such clear sources of correct thinking enables spiritual freedom, it can also leave us feeling adrift and uncertain. When I teach the coming of age class to our teenagers, I not only aim to get them thinking about these big questions of how do we live, but also to help them identify where they might go to find some answers. Or to put it in the same terms as the Gita, when you're facing down an epic battle and you're not sure what to do, who or what is sitting there in your chariot ready to help you figure it out? I'm not going to pretend that I totally understand all of what is going on in the Gita. As one website explained, you can read the 700 lines of poetry in the Gita in an afternoon, or you can spend a lifetime trying to parse its meaning. What is clear is that Krishna is genuinely trying to help Arjuna make sense of his situation. In the most quoted section of the Gita, which I read earlier, Arjuna essentially asked Krishna, "Yeah, but what does a wise person do? How do they talk, move, sit? How do you do wisdom?" Krishna's answer centers around two key ideas, renunciation and unification. On the one hand, Krishna emphasizes the need to renunciate attachment and aversion to the world of sense, which is to say, don't get lost in the experiences of wanting or of hating. The stuff of the world of sense is all transient. It will all go away. That's the stuff you let go of and renounce. On the other hand, seek out what is eternal and unchanging. Pursue unification with that, or actually with him, because for Krishna, he is eternal, the immortal self, which is both in all beings and beyond all. Seeking unification with the immortal self will bring freedom from samsara, Krishna teaches. Throughout the Gita, Krishna counsels Arjuna that the best way to pursue unification or the supreme state is via the path of self-discipline and devotion to Krishna. However, the Gita also acknowledges and discusses other ways to end up in the same ultimate place. I love this part of the Gita. Not only does this plurality of paths honor the vastness of the Hindu traditions and texts, it also affirms that different people with different personalities and circumstances will pursue or avoid the spiritual life in a variety of ways. In counseling Arjuna specifically, Krishna speaks to Arjuna as a man of action whose spiritual path is best pursued in the world. Krishna doesn't try to make Arjuna an ascetic monk by telling him to just leave the battlefield and the drama of his family behind. Rather, Krishna tells him to fight, as it is his duty in this life according to the circumstances of his caste and the historical moment. However, on the path of self-discipline, Arjuna must not be attached to the outcome of that battle. The outcome, who lives and who dies, is something Krishna controls, not Arjuna. Again, I do not fully grasp all of what Krishna is saying here or throughout the Gita. And yet something still resonates for me as a humanist-leaning Unitarian Universalist. I appreciate that the Gita is trying to figure out how to live rightly in the world. While many religious traditions have an ascetic element of monastic withdrawal, it's never really been a draw for me personally. Rather, after growing up evangelical Christian with its themes of distaste for things of the world, I have pursued a spiritual life that is rooted in the here and now and of the gifts of living on this planet as a human animal in the web of life. So the spiritual and ethical questions I have are of this world. Admittedly, this worldly emphasis is also why connecting with the Gita can be hard for me. Krishna's appeal to an immortal soul, the Atman, within each being that endures samsara or reincarnation, until returning to be with the eternal reality, the Brahman, is a belief I do not hold. And yet I am left wondering how this idea might connect with scientific understanding of the nature of matter as energy. In other words, I wonder about the origins of life and whether or not there is something that is infinite and immortal. Even as that big question hovers there, I am also aware of feeling a lot like Arjuna when he pleads to just know, but what do I do? Notably, Krishna doesn't just give Arjuna an action plan. Go fight and spend more time meditating too. Krishna gives Arjuna a cosmic vision of how the world works and his place in it. Only within this larger context does Krishna offer specific instructions. What is your cosmic vision of how the world works? Do you have one? Do you know how you fit in it? In the wider society in which we live, we're not always asked to sort out our cosmic beliefs. I believe we often hold them more or less consciously, even if we're not always asked to spell them out. And yet this is what we ask of our ninth graders, to wrestle with this through the coming of age program. What do you believe about God, or more broadly, the nature of the universe? What do you think happens to us when we die? What helps you to decide if an action is right or wrong? What do you do to help yourself in times of stress, struggle, and uncertainty? In my understanding, a religious and spiritual life is about these entwined questions of belief and practice. What do we believe about the nature of the universe, divinity, human nature? What do we do to bring meaning, ethical living, and purpose to our lives? Often we don't ask these big philosophical questions. Rather, we ask the questions we're facing in our daily lives and the relationships that bring us love or heartache, or so often both. How long can I hang on in this situation? Can I do this again? What will lead me to a new place, to a place of new freedoms, of joy, of peace? These questions also require frameworks of belief and practice. Do we believe that we are connected to others who love and care for us? Do we believe that we have control over some aspect of our life, our mind? Who or what do we believe will help us? What can we do to bring clarity or new energy to our spirit? Go for a walk with a friend? Deepen a meditation practice? Go to Sunday services? We all need beliefs and practices that anchor us in times of turmoil. These anchors may not be written down in an ancient religious text, but that's okay. We're Unitarian Universalists who recognize and support that there are many different spiritual paths and beliefs. And while we may not have gods posing as charioteers or Uber drivers, in our lives, hopefully we do have people to whom we can turn as we try to sort out and name just what we believe and what we can do that anchors our lives in purpose and meaning. Certainly my door is open to listen and support this search. Alyssa and Susie Keys are starting small groups shortly, and a meditation group meets weekly on Mondays. Supporting one another in our search for truth and meaning is central to who we are as a religious institution, as is supporting each other with care and compassion when our hearts cry out, how long? Or again? So may we continue this work and support of each other on this day and in the weeks, months, and years to come. Amen. Our closing hymn is another one from the teal hymnal, Wo Ya Ya. And Thanks to Polly, who picked this one, and it just fits so well. So please rise in body or in spirit. Whoa, yeah, yeah. 10:20.
Two things before we close.
I'm thinking today about my age and being a Gen Xer. I was born just before Roe v. Wade was passed, which should have turned 50 this last week. I just wanted to say that before the day closed. And also, that makes me a Gen Xer, and my Gen X heart is so happy today that for the first time I heard Indigo Girls in a church service. So thank you, Emily. Sustained by our connections to each other and to all that is holy, let us go and be beyond these walls, bringing more light and life, love and justice to our shared wonderful world. Amen.